Welcome to one of the first positive shows about America's opioid crisis. And no, I'm not going to be talking about all of the jobs that get created by selling a highly addictive drug. Instead, the Senate is about to pass the Opioid Crisis Response Act of 2018, which, talk about a slow response time, the doctor hit your knee with that little hammer about 10 years ago and you're like just jerked up. All signs point to the fact that this act is worth the wait though, as the bill is receiving bipartisan support and is about to get passed by Congress. That's right, sometimes politics can be happy. Today, I'm just gonna go over the major points of this bill to see what this thing is before it passes. There are 10 major points to get through, so don't be offended if I don't create a Ken Burns 100-hour documentary covering each one. I mean, this bill is 357 pages of fun. It reads like what would happen if John Steinbeck tried to solve the opium epidemic. Motion to remove the 3-page section about the rabbit crossing the road contributing nothing. Here's the list of major changes this act makes. Yeah, I have my work cut out for me making this news entertaining. Alright, so without further ado, let's jump right in.
The Senate Committee on Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions will please come to order. This hearing is for reviewing the Opioid Crisis Response Act of 2018.
Oh man, no wonder nobody's talking about this. That guy has the charisma of a particularly boring rock. He should write an anti-Trump article in the New York Times. So the first thing this act does is it reauthorizes funding from the Cures Act, which put $500 million a year towards the opioid crisis. I mean, I'm not sure what the Cure Act is, but it certainly doesn't sound bad. I know lobbyists are evil, but seriously, who's voting against the Cure Act? Basically, this act that was passed in 2016 funded fighting opioid abuse in 2017 and 2018, and it turns out it worked well enough to get extended to 2019. It basically gives states hardest hit by the opium crisis access to funds to fund local programs. It's pretty flexible as to what the states can choose to do, though there's some oversight, so they can't say, well, I'm the candidate who's toughest on opium, so this is going to my re-election campaign. Second, it creates a grant program for comprehensive opium recovery centers. It's similar to...
The CEO says they've been able to launch some of the programs out of their center because of funding from the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act, which was signed into law in 2016.
The big problem with the current system for dealing with opioid addiction is it's almost so comically inefficient that it could have only been set up by a bureaucracy. Basically, most of the opioid deaths are happening in small towns, and most of the comprehensive opioid recovery centers are located in big cities. Because that's where the experts are. I mean, it's a hard sell to get an MD to decide to move to a heroin-ragged small town in the far corner of nowhere. Previously, we had the ECHO, or Extension for Community Healthcare Outcomes program, which had top doctors teleconferencing patients from rural areas, the only time anyone has ever wanted to see a penis on webcam. But this program is the first one to directly provide grants to local communities looking to fund comprehensive opioid recovery centers. Before that, you had to get grants through states. And turns out that most states with major heroin problems aren't exactly flush with money and spend what money they do have on their biggest cities. So the third change is...
Some people argue Suboxone and methadone are just legal heroin, but advocates say there is proof. Medication-assisted treatment is saving lives and fighting addiction.
Great. Remember how pharmaceutical companies lying about painkillers created an opium epidemic? Well, now pharmaceuticals have come out with a solution. Lower-level opioids. Now, these drugs do cut mortality rates significantly, but you can probably imagine that not everyone is behind them. This new program would create a grant program that'll help healthcare practitioners obtain waivers easier so they can prescribe medications that are highly effective in treating opium addiction. You know, you could just make it easier to get waivers to prescribe these drugs, but I get it, that's so much paperwork, and sure, just throw money at it until the problem goes away. Fourth, it expands an existing problem that attempts to get more first responders, such as police and firefighters, to carry and use naloxone, a medication that reverses opioid overdoses. Well, that's definitely the simple version, but if you read the actual act, what it actually does is create a study to figure out what the barriers to providing these medicines are. Because it's a drug that cures overdoses, why wouldn't you carry it? There are a few issues. First, as we mentioned above, there are a lot of people overdosing on opioids.
We need about 1,000 units in Kane County to equip the rest of the first responders.
One issue is funding, says Kane County's coroner, who sits on a heroin task force.
I think they under budgeted how much they actually needed. The response was huge.
Those are going to be the logistical brunt of this study. Should be pretty simple. I mean, after a minute on Google, I found that. Hey government, I can have a report on your desk by Wednesday if I don't have to do my taxes this year. And my report will have jokes, so maybe the president will like it. Besides the distributional problems, there are two more ethical problems.
When they come out of their high, they're very angry, they wonder what we're doing in their house, what we're doing here, get out of their house. A lot of times they get into the life squad, we have to have a police officer ride with them, it's dangerous for the officer.
Some law enforcement agencies refuse to distribute this drug to officers, because sometimes in the act of saving a life of someone who's overdosing, they don't like the fact that you're there. You know, just like anyone else you would be arresting. Except this time, you're physically on top of them, and I don't know, they're recovering from an overdose. Heck, I can't even imagine throwing a punch when I'm slightly hungover. Also, and this is going to the dark side of things, but...
Well, some people say Narcan is a lifesaver, the best chance to have people have to live another day and get into treatment. Others say it's just an enabler. People overdose on heroin, are revived with Narcan, and then repeat the cycle all over again.
Yeah, so screw them. Now, to contextualize that appalling argument a little bit for a liberal, let me put it this way. What if we really leaned into mental health and it managed to stop mass shootings, but guns were continuing to flow into the community at an increased rate? These are the sorts of distributional hurdles that this study will be dealing with. The fifth thing this act does is it allows the federal government to pursue more research projects related to addiction and pain. Well, I would love to be more specific, but after reading through this, trust me, you really don't want me to be. This was nitpicky. It was like they had my high school English teacher edit it first. They literally went out of their way to strike a period and replace it with a semicolon. You know that was added by some senator who wanted to tell his constituents, "Hey, I helped write that." This basically just broadened the permitted research topics from the Public Health Service Act to include more pain and other research topics than before. The sixth thing this act does is it makes changes to Medicare and Medicaid to try to expand access to addiction treatment and limit the overprescription of opioid painkillers. For example, an Indiana representative pointed out,
what I think is interesting about this and draws a red flag for me is one of the things they talk about in here is a prescriber in my home state of Indiana wrote an average of 24 opioid prescriptions each for 108 beneficiaries in a year, costing Medicare Part D $1.1 million just to that Indiana physician.
That means that 108 people were getting a new prescription for opioid painkillers every 2 weeks for a year, costing more than $1 million to taxpayers. That's alarming, because it would take a lot to get me to voluntarily go to a doctor's office more than once a year. Every 2 weeks? He better be handing out something better than suckers. So, how do you stop doctors from selling Medicare recipients enough opioid painkillers to take down an elephant every time someone shows up with a stubbed toe? Well, this only works for government programs, because when it comes to healthcare, Uncle Sam keeps a copy of his receipts. This would tweak the Social Security Act to make it so that when something suspicious came up, the system will automatically escalate it to external review. As opposed to before, when regulators had the choice of deciding whether they wanted to have additional work or not. And I think we all know how that system went. Seventh, this act advocates for new initiatives to educate and raise awareness about proper pain treatment amongst healthcare providers. This one's pretty self-explanatory. If you're one of the few physicians who hands out painkillers like my mom hands out spaghetti, take some for the road is her way of saying goodbye. Well, this program is designed to correct that. This basically is making sure that any doctors that somehow missed the memo that all of this stuff is very addictive update their habits, and includes big things like updating the FDA prescription guidelines, and smaller things like changing opioid abuse to opium misuse and abuse in documents. Eighth, we see
U.S. Customs and Border Patrol officials seized a record amount of fentanyl and other synthetic opioids in the fiscal year that ends tonight.
This portion attempts to improve coordination between different federal agencies to stop illicit drugs like fentanyl at the border and gives agencies more tools. Now, you're probably thinking, well, that's just Trump restricting trade on another key Mexican export. In reality, the agencies we're talking about are the FDA and the Postmaster General, and it improves inspection and testing for all shipped mail to the United States. So, I guess if you're a drug dealer who goes by UPS, your days might be numbered. Yeah, sorry, I shipped your black tar heroin parcel post, so it's gonna be there in 5 to 7 business days. You can wait, right? What? Lost in the mail? We are gonna have to go to the post office and sign for it, I guess. Ninth, this act increases penalties for drug manufacturers and distributors related to the overprescribing of opioids. Alright, this one actually sounds more exciting than it is, because when you read it, it's another one of those change subsection A to remove the colon and put in a semicolon. But it basically just increases the amounts pharmaceuticals can be fined from 1/100 billionth of their profits to 1/10 billionth of their profits. That'll show them! Although,
Delaware is one of the states that recently filed a lawsuit against the pharmaceutical industry, joining 13 others. The state's attorney general is targeting the entire opioid supply chain, from manufacturers to distributors and chain drugstores.
So those lawsuits are actually happening, and a more intense punishment for doing something that's widely agreed to hurt a ton of people is considered good amongst most people. The last thing this act does is it puts more money towards law enforcement programs meant to stop illegal drug trafficking. Come on, it's a Trump-era drug act. You knew there was going to be at least one border section. So this allocates $1.5 billion towards keeping a program that supports DEA agents in high-intensity drug trafficking areas funded through 2020. Well, okay, that makes a lot of sense. Whew, we're done. Now, there are plenty of more specific things that this bill does, and if you're interested in reading more, don't! This thing is really long. Again, we're talking 357 pages. Although, if you read the table of contents, it should give you a pretty good idea of, well, the contents. Even better, the main criticism of this bill is that it doesn't go far enough. And while that's not great, it seems pretty unanimous that this is a step in the right direction. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, hope you enjoyed that video. The great thing about small channels like this one is I read the feedback and sometimes yikes, but I could create more episodes looking into the intricacies of legislation. But first, I'd love to know if this is something you guys actually care about. So let me know in the comments if you want more legislation breakdowns. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And ring that Liberty Bell to keep freedom ringing. Give me a thumbs up, and just as always, thank you for watching.